We are really excited today. More than 150 people registered for today's webinar from over 25 countries. So thank you very much. This is the 12th webinar of the Mexican Institute of Water Technology Espacio del Conocimiento en Línea webinar series. My name is Mauricio and I will be your host today. Before introducing our speaker, I would like to give you some key messages. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them on the Zoom's chat room, or if you're watching from Facebook Live, please do so in the comment box. We will have a Q&A session after the presentation where we will try to answer as many as possible. Also, all webinars are recorded and available soon afterwards on our social media shown on your screen. So please make sure to follow us if you want to watch again this presentation or any other of the webinar series. So now let me introduce you to Angelica Tarpanelli. We are very pleased to have her as a speaker today. She holds a master's degree in civil engineering, which she received with honors from the University of Perugia in Italy in April 2006. The same year, she received a scholarship and successively a research fellowship to carry out research at the Research Institute of Geohydrological Protection of the National Research Council in Perugia under the project title Hydrological Monitoring of Extreme Events. Since September 2012, she has been a researcher in his research institute. In January 2014, she received her PhD in Hydraulic Engineering at the University of Perugia. The title of her thesis was remote sensing for hydraulic application in small and medium basins. Angelica, the audience is yours. I will stop sharing, so the screen is yours as well.
Okay, thank you. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Very good. So, okay. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. I don't know where you are, but it's a pleasure to me to show you the research activity that I started around 10 years ago. And today I want to show you the main results that I get from these activities, and also some idea for the future research. The topic is the multi-mission satellite observations for river discharge estimation. Of course, it is my main topic, but it is also the topic of most of the people here at the IRP CNR hydrology group. Why river discharge? Because it is a very important variable and used for many aspects. It is defined as the volume of water flowing into a river in a unit time, and it is one of the essential climate variables selected by GCOS as an important variable in driving the climate system. In fact, it is considered a key variable in the water cycle. It is essential for water resource management. It is necessary for the flood prediction and the hydraulic risk mitigation. And it is also a support for identifying and adapting the potential effects of climate change. And it is important for the reduction of the ocean salinity and the thermaline circulation as well. In 2015, United Nations defined this 17 sustainable development goals, in which for each member state there are urgent actions to be done for all countries, so for the developing and developed countries. And specifically for the sixth development goals, that is the clean water and sanitation, there is the need to take urgent measures for a more efficient use and management of water to addressing the growing demand for water, threats to water security, and increasing the frequency and severity of drought and floods resulting from climate change. So, as this important the importance of river discharge is quite high. And so now what I would like to show you is how measured river discharge from in situ and especially and specifically for from satellite observations. For more than a century, river discharge has been indirectly estimated in the river through ground measurements of water depth, water velocity, and channel cross-section depth, that is the bathymetry. Here in the photos, you can see the main instruments that we use for measure these variables, like the hydrometric stage, ultrasonic hydrometer, radar hydrometer for water depth, or a topographic survey for bathymetry, but also the acoustic Doppler current profiler that is also used for water flow velocity, along with the radar, the current meter, the radar gun, and the ultrasonic flow meter. All these instruments are included in the what we call traditional monitoring network that as it is very important, but it has also many issues. For example, it is not representative of the global water flow. It has high costs of installation and maintenance, and it cannot be installed in many remote areas. Moreover, there are other problems related to the fact that globally this monitoring network it is not uniformly distributed. Many areas are still unmonitored, and the number of the gauging stations has decreased. In these two figures that come from very recent papers of Crushmore et al., you can see on the left a figure of the average percentage of data availability in the last around 60 years. And you can see how the world is divided from a very high percentage of data of a monitoring system and a few data available from the society. For example, in Africa, we have countries with no data at all. In the right figure, you can see the proportion of stations in time. So, and all this shape, the bell shape, indicates us that the number of instruments are decreasing. So, the hydrologic community and in general the climate community, we are thinking how to use other source of data to measure river discharge. In fact, this matter increased the interest to apply remote sensing data for hydrological purposes, and also the fact that this the satellite data are growing in the last year, foster the monitor of different physical parameters to be observed by satellites. In this paper that is published last year, we give an overview of the different satellites that can measure river discharge. And it is a review of different studies that use the radar altimetry, passive microwave and near-infrared sensors, and also some fusion techniques for the river discharge estimation. Of course, radar altimetry is the main satellite, the more important satellite for the estimation of river discharge, because it is able to give us a direct measure of the water level. For the other sensor, like the near-infrared sensors, we need to process a proxy of hydraulic variables. But all these aspects will be and deal with during this presentation. Just a few words about how to how to work the radar altimetry. Altimeters measure the range between the satellite altitude and the water surface observed at nadir. So the water height, it is given by the orbit altitude minus the range depurated by the corrections. Basically, it is a radar, so the radar transmits a short pulse of microwave radiation with a certain power towards a target surface. The pulse interacts with this surface and part of the radiation reflects back to the altimeter. The time to go and come back, the time for the signal to go and come back, divided the speed of light provide a range of the measure. There are three generations of altimeter technologies. One is the classical low resolution mode. The other one is the synthetic aperture radar technology. And the last one is the one that will be installed in the next mission SWAT, the interferometric delay Doppler technology. Here in this slide, you can see all the altimetry satellites that we had in the past, in the present, and in the future. Basically, this slide is to show you that from 1991, we have a continuous monitoring of water level by radar altimetry. And even if it is designed for the ocean and for oceanography, this satellite was very useful also for hydrological applications. In green, you can see the satellites currently in orbit today, and in orange, the future mission that will be launched next year. Each mission has some characteristics linked to the altitude, the kind of altimeter, the frequency band, but what we as a hydrologic community, what we look at is the revisit time and the intertrack. That are the two main characteristics very useful for our applications. And basically, these satellites can be these characteristics are very similar. For example, for TOPEX Poseidon and the family JSON, we have a revisit time of 10 days and intertrack of about 300 kilometers. Instead, for example, for ERS and AMBISAT and SARAL satellites, we have a revisit time of 35 days, but a lower intertrack of 80 kilometers. Different characteristics for Sentinel-3 or, for example, for Cryosat. What does it mean? It means that if we have this image in the background, you can see the basin, the Amazon basin, and there are some rivers that you can observe. In the yellow line, the yellow line are the track of altimeter. So in this case, we can observe the track of TOPEX Poseidon in the family JSON. So with one measure each 10 days and 300 kilometers of intertrack. And for each river, you can observe this river by satellite with in different position that we call virtual station, that are the intersection between the track and the river. So in this case, we have, for example, in the Negro River, three virtual station, and in the Amazon, three virtual station. But if we pass to the other satellites with 35 days of revisit time and 80 kilometers of intertrack, we increase the number of virtual station, like 10 for the Negro River, for example, and 13 in the Amazon. But if we look at Cryosat, that has 7 kilometers of intertrack and about 1 day, 1 year of revisit time, the situation is completely different. So for us, the challenge is how to use this kind of data, because we are used to work with data ground measurements with 15 minutes of frequency. So also they think we need to rethink how to use this data for our applications. For people that don't know where to download this data, I listed a sort of Alpi Hydro portals in which you can download directly the water level without any reprocess of the raw data of altimetry. And if you don't see the target that you look for, I think it is easy to contact the people of these portals that are welcome to give you this data. So the problem in this case is how to manage this data sets that are very, very different to each other and very different also for our applications. Basically here, we study in a collaboration with the University of Stuttgart, we study a way to merge the different satellites in the way that we can use all the information that we have in a river niche. Why? Basically, because if we observe a water level in an upstream section, this water level is linked to the water level in the downstream section. So the connectivity of the river and also the hydraulic law that describe the flow into the river can be very useful to define this kind of merging approach. And in this case, we collect different data from Topex Poseidon, Envisat, Cryosat-2, and Sara Laltica along the River Po, and we validate this time series that it could be possible to obtain along all the section of the river. We validate this time series in five gauge stations along the Po River. But how to estimate river discharge from radar altimetry? There are different methods. The simpler is the rating curve. The rating curve is a functional law linking the water stage to the discharge, and it is traditionally very useful also in the classical hydrology. So in the majority of the studies, a rating curve is developed considering the water level derived by satellite altimetry and the discharge observed in the nearest ground sections. And on this respect, the utility of this method can be seen, for example, for all the stations that are dismissed after a certain point. So in this figure on the right, you can see in blue the ground measurements of discharge, whereas in red the discharge is simulated by using the rating curve with altimetry data. So this is a very simple example to show how to extend, for example, the time series a long time by using the satellite. And it is also very useful, for example, for the estimation of climate trend that needs a very long time series, and often we don't know, we don't have the availability of this long-term series. Another applications of the radar altimetry is with the rainfall runoff models. In fact, the rating curve can be built not only with the observed discharge, but also with the simulated discharge, for example, by an hydrological model. In this case, in the table, you can have some literature of reference that use this information, but we have a simple example that we present during an AGU conference, in which we show, we apply the MISD model, that is a semi-distributed rainfall runoff model that we implemented internally in our group, and we apply this model to the to some basins or some subcatchments of the Congo Basin, and we compare the discharge coming from this model to the water level coming from the two altimetry data sets, MBSAT and SARAL, and we observed that the water level retrieved by altimetry is consistent with the model discharge, and this is very useful for all the operation like the data assimilation that can be applied and implemented in the model to improve the simulation of the river discharge. Another model, another way to apply the radar altimetry is with the hydraulic modeling. Also in this case, we have the table in which there are some useful reference to read. And basically, approaches, hydraulic approaches can vary from employing simple to complex hydraulic models, going, for example, from steady uniform flow to unsteady flow. And in this case, we publish a study in which we compare two simple hydraulic models. One is the rating curve model developed by Mora Marco et al. In 2001, that is based on the proportional between the flow area and the discharge between a section upstream and downstream. And another method is the Berkeley formulas that are quite common in hydrology because they are very fast and they are validated in many sites. In this case, the W and the Epsilon are referring to the mean width and mean height that are the width and height of the equivalent area of the cross section. In this case, we compare the results of the two methods. Both are able to estimate river discharge by using the information coming from two virtual stations along the Po River. And better results are obtained with the rating curve model, but just because we calibrate the model, the parameter of the model directly on these sites, whereas for the Berkeley formula, this the value of the parameters were calibrated in other sites. More complex hydraulic model can be used also with the use of with the altimetry water level, and the purpose in this case is to calibrate the friction coefficient, the roughness coefficient. In this case, I want to show you two examples. One is the paper on with Domenichetti, University of Bologna, in which we test the potential of the water level derived from two virtual stations along the Po River in the quasi two-dimensional hydraulic model in ECRAS. And we show that the integration of satellite data sets with traditional in-situ observations fosters the trustworthiness and the reliability of the hydraulic model. And this is because basically we can calibrate the roughness parameter only by using satellite data. Another example is always in the Po River, but this study was done in collaboration with the DTU, an institute in Denmark. And in this case, we use the Cryosat satellite, the satellite with 1 year of revisit time and 7 kilometers of intertrack. And in this case, what we obtain is a very, very good results, because we were able to estimate the Mannen coefficient along all the river. So the plot, the bottom right plot, show the behavior of the roughness coefficient along all the channel. And this is not possible also with the in situ station, because that is represented by the dashed line, black line. This because also with in situ easy to station. We can have in the pop, we have the section, it's some 30 kilometers, I think. But in this case, with a very high spatial resolution of the satellites, we can get more information. So in this case, we demonstrate that the spatial resolution is more important than the temporal resolution, at least for the hydraulic model. The last example of hydraulic model is an example for the 2D model, and it is done with this flood in collaboration with the UNESCO UNESCO Institute. And in this case, we were in the Danube River, and we calibrate the model with a flood event in 2006 and validate the model in another flood event. We don't calibrate just the roughness of in this case, we calibrate the roughness of the flood plain and the depth of the section, because we didn't know the bathymetry of the river along all the channel. So the application of this the radar altimetry are very, very different, and it is also very useful for many, many applications. For another, passing to another satellite and another sensor, I want to show you how to estimate river discharge for near infrared images. The method is based on the different behavior in the near infrared region, the different behavior between a water pixel and a land pixel. So if we look at a water pixel, a wet pixel, with increasing of the water level, we observed a decreasing of the reflectance. A reflectance that should be remain constant for a land pixel. This is the theory, but in the reality, due to the different noises and the atmosphere effect, these two signals are not so clear. And so what we exploit in this case is the ratio between the land pixel and the water pixel. Land pixel called C, that is calibration, and the water pixel called M for measurement. And what we did was to observe 7 years of MODIS images in this case, and we look at two specific pixels, and we did this ratio of reflectance. And we observed that the ratio of reflectance can be related to hydraulic variables like discharge or flow velocity with a good approximation. In fact, these are the results for the link between C over M reflectance ratio and discharge in the Po River for four sites, and the results are that we obtain are very good. So we think also how to use this information. And a way to use this information is to merge the information with the altimetry. In fact, if we look at the physical approach to use to derive river discharge is given by the flow area times the velocity. So the velocity can be derived from this signal, because the signal can be representative of discharge, but of course can be also related to the velocity, that is a variable linked to the discharge. For the flow area, that is a function of water level and geometry, we can use the altimetry for the water level, and in this case we use both unknown geometry by a survey and unknown geometry derived from a method developed by Mora Marco in 2013. And the discharge that we obtain is the plot in the bottom, in which the green line is the in situ discharge, whereas the blue and red line represent the simulated discharge by merging the two satellites, MODIS and altimeter. The red is and the simulated discharge with the without the knowledge of the cross-section bathymetry, but with the use of the entropy approach. So what we conclude on this study that we have two main issues. One is the underestimation of the peaks, the peak values, due to the fact that MODIS is an optical sensor. So during the flood events, the sky is covered by clouds and the satellite cannot see the river. So we don't have information during high flow. And the second issue is the low frequency of the time series due to the altimeter revisit time. In fact, in this study, we merge only the information what we have about the satellite. So in this case, we use just a virtual station, one virtual station coming from Envisat. So we have an information each 35 days. We implemented this method, and I would like to show you these results that coming from a very recent project, RideSat, funded by ESA through an open call. And this project was done with the DTU Space in Denmark. And we tried, the purpose was to derive river discharge by using three satellite sensors that are on board Sentinel-3. Altimeter, near infrared multispectral satellites like Olchi, and thermal sensor. But unfortunately, with thermal sensor, we don't get very good results. So finally, we merge only the information coming from altimeter and near infrared. And in the plot on the right, you can see some example of discharge coming from some rivers from Danube, Po, Amazon, and Mississippi. I'm sorry that you cannot see very well the time series, but in gray there is the observation discharge, whereas with the other colors you can see the simulated discharge, the different colors coming from different combinations of products, of satellite products. So basically, we are able now to estimate river discharge by merging the two approaches. But we are still linked to the knowledge, at least of some years of gauge of river discharge observed through traditional monitoring network. This is another example how to merge the two information, because one question is, are we sure that the two satellites can give us a real good information. So we use this machine learning approach through the neural network analysis. And as an input, we consider the water level from multi-mission altimetry and different product of the reflectance coming from the near infrared band. MODIS from Aqua, MODIS from Terra, and MERIS sensors. All these input are put in the feed-forward neural network to derive river discharge. We trained the neural network in different combinations. So in the plot above, you can see the neural network trained with single satellite like altimetry, just MERIS, MODIS Aqua, MODIS Terra. And what I would like to stress is the fact that with this single satellite, the observed discharge, it is the simulated discharge, it is not very good to represent the observation. Whereas if we start to combine the information like MERIS altimetry, MODIS and MODIS and MERIS, we can start to observe some good estimation. But the best is to use all the information that we have in the river. So in this case, we have in the plot on the left, the biggest plot, we observed that the Observed discharge and the simulated discharge are very good, and they are in agreement, as demonstrated also by the times the temporal series plotted on the right. This study was done in two basins, in Niger River at Locoya and Nicola River at Ponte Lagoscuro, and the results that we get were very, very good. In green, the observation discharge, and in red, the simulated discharge. And you can see that the red is almost always above the green line. Another example is forecasting activities, because if we think to use the information that comes from satellites upstream, maybe we have some chance to derive discharge downstream. Of course, we need a basin in which the lateral contribution is at least proportional to the upstream basin, and also we don't need any confluence or critical human intervention between the two sections. But if we have a very smooth situation, we are able to link the reflectance ratio, for example, or also the altimetry at time t with a discharge at time t plus the wave travel time, with a very simple relationship. And in this case, the three plots in the bottom show the results, the results with the different satellites, and the black line is the observation discharge during a flood event. And in this case, we observed that with daily MODIS, for example, we can get very good information about the forecasted discharge. Also with altimetry, because we have more accurate information, but as usual, we have this information with low frequency. Just a remark that finally we have a satellite sensor able to we will have a satellite sensor able to measure discharge. In fact, this is the mission, Surface Water and Ocean Topography Mission, that is developed by NASA, CNES, Canadian Space Agency, and the UK Space Agency. And it is scheduled for launch in 2022. It is a mission that brings together two communities, oceanography and hydrology. Basic characteristics of this sensor is the fact that it has a radar interferometer with two swath of 50 kilometers, and it has a 21-day repeat orbit, 3 years nominal mission lifetime. But what we like most is the fact that it is able to measure rivers wider than 100 meters, and maybe also up to 50 meters. That represents most of the rivers in the world. So SWAT will provide simultaneously measurements of water surface elevation, slope, and also river extent. And there are a very intense activity of discharge algorithm working group of SWAT for this mission, because river discharge, it is one of the requirements of the mission. And in this link, you can find a lot of publications of this group related both river discharge, but also other hydraulic variables like the geometric variables like water height, slope, base flow, bathymetry, width, water surface area. So, just some remark for the take-home message. This is not the first one, but okay. The optimization of the emerging procedure represents an added value to the information derived by single sensor data, and widens the possibilities of increasing the accuracy of river discharge estimates. First, it was the altimetry, that the fact that altimetry is a valid technique for hydrologic and hydraulic applications, especially for river discharge. The optical and passive microwave sensors are able to estimate the variation of river discharge in rivers. And there is another one. Yeah. The availability of satellite data allows us to reproduce long and global time series of river discharge to be used also for analyze the climate trend. And of course, the future SWOT data will provide a good perspective on improving and refining the estimates of river discharge where available, but also providing river discharge at engaged sites and remote areas. Thank you for your attention. And this is my contact, and I'm glad to answer to all the questions.
Thank you very much, Angelica, for such an interesting talk. Certainly having multiple ways to estimate river discharge comes very handy, since water resources management is not possible without accurately having this variable. So now I'm gonna share my screen. Before starting the Q&A session, and while the audience finished typing their questions, I would like to remind participants, just give me a second so I can share my screen. So here's our social media. So if you want to see this presentation again, please go and follow us. Also, I'd like to remind you, tomorrow we'll have a regular Friday webinar. It'll be titled Deep Learning para asistir en la predicción de incendios forestales. As usual, this one will be in Spanish. So we'll go with the questions now.
Okay.
So I have a couple of related questions. The first one, it says, what will be the minimum width of the river we can use to the radar altimeter? And the other one related is, which discharge do you think is the minimum value that can be measured?
About the minimum width of the river, we simulated the river with a good accuracy for river at up to 100 meters with a Sentinel-3 satellite. So we are waiting for SWOT to be more accurate for smaller width, but so far with the satellite that we have, we can have a good approximation on this width. I would like also to remark that the Sentinel-3 has this fully focused SAR technology, and the recent paper demonstrates that it is able to reproduce accurate water level also for smaller target, smaller than 100 meters. About the discharge, it depends, because sometimes the river width, it is not completely representative of the discharge flowing into the river. So I don't know, I have, for my experience, I was able to derive discharge also for low flow. Low flow means not only for high flow. So this means that I was able to reproduce the discharge also for very, very low value. I cannot answer with a number for the minimum value.
All right. Thank you very much. From Ronald Ontiveros, what are the best open source software options for the for processing of radar altimetry data and hydraulic modeling for river discharge estimation?
It is not very clear for me this question, because for open source software for processing radar altimetry is a question, and open source software For hydraulic model, for me is another question, because basically what we implemented is how to use water level already derived from other processing, and we use in our model ECRAS, Mach 11, but ECRAS is free, Mach 11 is not free, but so I know that for other altimetry processing, there is a BRAT, there is a open source software that you can find in the www.altimetry.org, maybe, if I remember well, but it is a software very useful for processing radar altimetry, and also there is also a processor from ESA, for example, that is the GPOD, in which you can directly process altimetry dataset from Sentinel-3 and Cryosat with their processor Salvatore.
All right, our next question from Ulises. Do you consider the available information is enough for calibration, or is it necessary to increase the measurement at a river level in order to obtain better results for the simulations?
I think that we can work with what we have. So many times we don't have enough information for calibration. It is true. And it depends on the availability of the data around the world. So for the developed countries like Europe or USA, we don't have many problems. But when we move to the other country, especially in developing countries where they are not available to share the information of discharge or water level, we met a lot of problems to calibrate the models, and also yes, to obtain good results, because if we don't have information, it's difficult to obtain good results.
Thank you. Now from Agustin Breña, what is the temporal and spatial resolution of the RightSat project?
We get the discharge every 3 days, because up to every 3 days, not for all the sites, because in this case, the temporal resolution, depending on the altimetry datasets, and DTU did a very good job, because they were able to merge different satellite tracks, Saraltica, Sentinel-3, Cryosat-2, and with this information they get for most of the sites one data each 3 days. In this case, with MODIS or OLCHI, we have availability of this data set nearly daily, so we were able to give a product with this resolution. About the spatial resolution, the sites that we observed went from 100 meters of width until 2-3 kilometers in the Amazon, and but unfortunately we don't have a global product, so we have just 20 sites in which we derive information of river discharge.
Thank you very much. Our next question from Yoko. Is there any World River Discharge Model product that's available right now, at least for big rivers around the world?
Yes, I know that there are many models, but derived from land surface model or rainfall runoff model. These are quite different from the model that I use and the model that I used to work, because what I look at is local, very local information. Instead, these other methods are globally, but they are linked to the rainfall runoff process, and this means that the spatial resolution is very good, but they lose the accuracy in the local section of the river. Actually, we are working, we like community, not we like me and my group, for the global global level product for river discharge, because satellites, the characteristics of satellites is continuity and the global coverage. So what we hope is in the near future is to be able to exploit all this information for derive and for retrieve a good global product for river discharge.
Our next question from Agustin as well. I think questions keep coming. Could you please explain how did you infer flow velocity using MODIS imagery?
Basically, we exploit this reflectance ratio. The reflectance ratio between a dry and wet pixel is affected by the fact that if you look at the pixel close to the river, this pixel becoming wet, and the moisture, the soil moisture, could be related to the flow into the river, because during a flood event, you can imagine a flood event, and this flood event, the pixel, during the flood event, the pixel becoming wet. But with the normal regime of the river, the pixel, it is almost dry. So this variation of the soil moisture into the pixel, it is observable from the reflectance, from the satellite reflectance. And so we linked this information with the river discharge, and hence with the flow velocity, because the flow velocity and river discharge are quite related, no? So, and the river discharge has a greater range of variability. Instead, for the flow velocity, we have this almost the same range all over the world. So it is better to work with these hydraulic variables with respect to the discharge.
All right, thank you very much. I think you already talked a little bit about this, but Ki Wang is asking, is there any way to derive velocity for narrow rivers? For example, 100 meters width solely from satellites currently?
We are studying, so far we analyzed just the medium resolution satellites like MERIS, MODIS, OLCHI, with a spatial resolution of 250 meters, 300 meters. We are working on higher resolution with like 30 meters Landsat or better, 10, 20 meters with Sentinel-2. And there are some, I think one study in literature in which they derive good results for the Tibet Plateau, I think, with Landsat. 30 meters, and this means that we can observe also smaller and narrow river with this resolution. But we are working on, so I cannot give you an absolute answer to this question. I hope.
Thank you very much. Next question: how sensitive is the model if you improve the spatial resolution of imagery, for example, shifting from MODIS to Sentinel? So 10 meter to 3 meter resolution.
Okay, we so far, as I explained before, we have just a few examples with Sentinel-2. And Sentinel-2 is able to provide us very, very good results, much better of MODIS or MERIS. So my feeling is that we can get an improvement on the estimation of by moving with a higher resolution, but so far I don't have this kind of answer.
Thank you very much. Our next question from Brahma. Are altimetry-based river height changes corrected for vertical land movement due to solid earth processes?
I think it is. It's referring to something related to the topography or related to the process of movement, like landslides?
Yeah, I think they are talking about that.
Basically, this question is more related to the land and not to the water. So,
yeah.
What altimetry? The advantage of altimetry in hydrology is the fact that. Sorry, wait a minute.
No problem.
Okay. Yes, the advantage of altimetry is the fact that the waveform that you observed from the water is very, very brilliant with respect to the land, so you can recognize easily the water body from the land. About the land, I don't have this information because I'm not an altimetry expert, so I cannot answer, but I can ask to my colleagues from the altimetry community if there is the possibility to see some movement of the land also from altimeters.
Thank you very much. Now Mom is asking how to validate for engaged areas for using streamflow data.
It is a very good question because we have difficulties to validate for engaged areas. I know that so far, especially with the SWOT group, they have also method that can be used for engaged area because they don't need any parameter to be calibrated. And so they can estimate river discharge all over the world. Validate this kind of model is quite challenging because the only thing that you can do is validate with something that you have. So an alternative could be use other information coming from other satellites or other model. So by using, for example, some rainfall runoff model, maybe you can have an information about the magnitude of the volume of water flowing into the channel. And I don't know, I don't have any other idea on this respect.
Thank you. Our next question is a little bit related to the previous one. Jocelyn is asking, the studies that you mentioned where satellite data is used to calibrate hydrological models, was it also applied to neighboring catchments by means of measuring the transferability of calibrated parameters to the neighboring catchments? For example, catchments where there's no observed data.
Yes, in fact, sometimes there is an easy way to work for engaged area is to use all the parameters that you calibrate in other similar catchment. So by similarity, or you can use also information in the neighboring basin, but it is not obvious that neighboring basin have the same characteristics. One solution could be to divide the different basins into the climate region, into the regime of flow. So the Niger and the Po River are completely different. So river characterized by seasonality are very different from the river, for example, in Europe, that are in a area completely different. And we don't have this monsoon season that has seasonal effect on the river discharge. So yes, the answer to the question is yes, we can apply this kind of regionalization method to estimate river discharge for engaged sites.
Our next question from Mazhar Omar. If satellite altimeter passes some kilometer above or downstream the in-situ water level station, then how to compare both water levels? This is water level from altimeter and in-situ water level.
Generally, we use, when we compare the water level derived from altimeter to the gauge station, generally we use the closest gauge stations. That means at least 20 kilometers, 30 kilometers, but not more far than this. And so in this case, we can generally we consider the slope like interpolation between the gauge station that we have, or if we have information about the bathymetry of the river, we consider the surface level derived from a simple model, like a uniform slope, or generally when we have to compare the altimetry and the in-situ station, we remove the mean, the average, the temporal average of the time series in order to have the same reference, and then we can add the in-situ station's mean. In this way, we have a time series consistent with the in-situ station, and we can have consistent result.
Thank you very much. Now from Jessica, did you consider using NDWI?
I started to before to see to look at the reflectance, because I use the reflectance in band 2. But before we use also this kind of index, NDVI and NDWI, and we didn't get good results. I would like to underline that this index could be very useful to investigate also the situation for the dry pixel. In fact, when we there are margin to improvement of the method, okay? So when we look at the dry and wet pixel, we consider the dry pixel as a reference point, but during the flood events, if this pixel is located in the urban area, as usual put this pixel, the urban area can be not flooded, but for sure could be wet because of the soil without any infiltration, and this could affect the ratio during the high flow. With this kind of index, we can have a sort of indicators for understand how many water is in the pixel, or if there are something to add or something to cut from this information. So I think I don't use this index, but my plan is to use in the next future.
All right. Our next question, I think you already answered it, but I will ask it anyways. Is it worthy to link the dry and wet pixel ratios to water depth, as it is also a function of discharge? So I don't know if you want to add something else.
Sorry. Where can I read the...
Is it from Devi Prasad? I can read it again. Is it worthy to link the dry and wet pixel ratios to water depth?
Good question, because basically I did during the RightSat project we did a sort of sensitivity analysis of the ratio C over M with different hydraulic variables, water level, the flow velocity, the discharge, the river width, surface width, and the flow area. And we observed contrasting results, because not all the rivers behave in the same way. So for the Po River, we observed that this C over M ratio is more related to the flow velocity, and it comes also from the publications that we have in the past. But for Mississippi, for example, or the Red River, in which we have other in-situ data to compare this, to do this analysis, we observed different behavior. Sometimes it is C over M is linked to the width, and sometimes it is linked to the water level. So it is not so obvious that the pixel is related to one hydraulic variables. What we are sure is that the ratio is able to derive a variation of the flowing water into the channel. And I think it deserves more investigations to understand how far we can go with this approach.
Thank you very much, Angelica. I think those were all the questions. So now let's go with Agustin Breña for the closing remarks.
Okay.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Tarpanelli, for this interesting talk. It's the last one from a series of three seminars that were given by the hydrology research group from Dr. Luca Brocca. From the Consiglio Nazionale delle Ricerche in Italy. So for the talk from today, Dr. Tarpanelli basically provided quite a few results about how we can reconstruct stream flow in large rivers using space-borne products. She started giving some advances of satellite-based radar altimetry over the last 15 years, and the limitation that remained to be addressed. She also provided some good examples about how altimetry data can be used to calibrate the roughness of the river cross section. In this case, the Manning's coefficient, and also how can we use simple hydraulic models to estimate river discharge. She also provided some results about the estimation of river discharge using near infrared images, and the results display were very were very good in Nora, and she gave some insights about how you can incorporate imagery with altimetry. For instance, how you can estimate flow velocity using MODIS or other imagery product. And she also showed the potential for flood forecasting. In this case, how you can follow or infer the wave propagation downstream, assuming that the lateral contribution remains uniform throughout the river channel. And finally, she talked about the capabilities of the upcoming surface water and ocean topography satellite that will be launched in 2022. So we'd like to thank Dr. Tarpanelli, and also this is on behalf of the Ministry of environment and natural resources of Mexico. I would like to thank them, all three, Dr. Luca Broca, Dr. Cristian Massari, and of course, Dr. Tarpanelli for these seminars. And we hope that this is the beginning of a fruitful collaboration between IMTA and Consiglio Nazionale della Ricerca. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone. Before leaving, could you please all turn in your camera so we can take a picture of all of us? Please, everyone, don't be shy. Thank you. Great. So in the count of three, say cheers. Just smile. One, two, three. Awesome. Great, thank you very much. Thank you, Angelica. This was a very interesting talk. Thank all our Zoom and Facebook viewers. We hope to see you again on our next webinar. Please stay safe. Goodbye.
Thank you, bye.
Thank you.